me to invite all of our key speakers for the first session to come on stage. Dr. Rajiv Kumar, who will be chairing the session. Mr. Jagdish Khattar. Ambassador Aftab Seth. Mr. Shekhar Vishwanathan. Dr. Ajit Ranade. And Shri Mayur S. Shah.
Thank you, Dhaval. Thank you very much for making it clear that my primary role is that of a timekeeper, which is what I do very well, actually. And also, the fact is that after the inaugural session and then with all the experts and luminaries on the dais and in the audience, the chair shouldn't have much more more role than that of a timekeeper, except, of course, to warn my speakers that they've given us 10 minutes each, so that's the job that I'll have to do. Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to make three or four very small points before inviting our speakers. And I'll not introduce them, simply because the organizers have done a wonderful job of having their detailed bios printed here. And let me just sort of say that I've been, my first visit to Japan was in 1985. And so I've been actually observing Indo-Japan relations for a fairly sort of some time now. And the fact remains that at the end of 2012-13, India-Japan bilateral trade was, I think, about $14 billion. And in beginning of 2000, it was about $3 billion. And we can suppose say that, look, we've done very well, our trade has increased four times, as it were, in these 10 years. So that means it has doubled almost 5 years or in 6 years. And therefore, one can sort of pat ourselves on the back and say that this is it. But at the same time, ever since 1985 and onwards, one of my jobs, unfortunately, has been to compare Indo-Japan with China-Japan and Indo-China with Indo-Japan. And if you look at it in this context, just that same one figure that at the end of 2012, the Sino-Japanese trade, bilateral trade, was, believe it or not, $335 billion. So therefore, while we can congratulate ourselves on history, if you look at it in relative terms, with others, suddenly the possibilities open up, and also that one thing opens up that there must have been some periods between 85 to now where the two countries stopped engaging with each other. And they went away from each other for whatever reasons. Maybe it was the attraction of China or what. So the point that I want to make today is that this morning we should think about a period of re-engagement beginning between India and Japan. And therefore forget the past. Also stop thinking in past terms. Japan can only help us in manufacturing. Now that's, as far as I'm concerned, that we should go much beyond it because manufacturing globally has changed completely. And therefore, if Japan is not going to come and produce pastas and noodles and light engineering goods and food products here, maybe we should look to Japan for, how are they doing their automation, their robotics, their artificial intelligence, and where our software expertise and their hardware expertise can come together. Simple point is that we today have to think ab initio. Another example, and that's the second point that I want to make, is that in the change context today, globally, India-Japan relationship will have to take on very different contours. And by that, example is that both Japan, but much more than Japan, India, is going to face the environmental pressure on its growth hugely. The carbon constraint will start biting, on India very much as we go ahead, as you go in the future, so that we will have to reduce our per GDP unit of carbon emissions as we go in forward. So therefore, for example, so Khattar is here, so with due respect to him, the strategy of personal transport driving growth forward through an automobile industry which has huge multiple linkages and employs massive and so on. The strategy of the post-war years that the US and Europe and maybe Japan had followed by the automobile driving the economy forward, India may not have that luxury. So therefore, Japan has done this wonderful job of creating the public transport system in our country, you know, which is at, you know, metros and so on, because that might be the route to go in a carbon-constrained economy. Point I'm making is that in the changed context of the world, India-Japan relationship must begin to look for new avenues. And the third point, and this is the final point, is that, no, two more, and then I'll ask. Third is that India has this huge problem of employing 1 million new jobs per month. And our youth is there, is aspirational, is, you know, impatient, is waiting for these jobs. So Japan's assistance, if it comes in hugely employment intensive industries, will be good for us. And to my mind, tourism is one of the things that has come forward to me. And the other is, of course, human resource development. I've been advocating the much wider spread of Japanese language teaching in our countries. Hasn't yet heard a sympathetic response, but why shouldn't we have Japanese language teachings in our state capitals is beyond me. And the final point is that, and I used the first seminar that I attended in Dhaka was funded by the Japanese Foreign Ministry on regional cooperation in South Asia. Japan and India together can bring a huge stability and prosperity in this region called South Asia. So India-Japan relationship must go beyond a bilateral context and must see itself as bringing peace, prosperity, stability to this region as a whole, which, by the way, in 30 years from now, will have about 2 billion people living here. So, you know, so that's the order of the magnitude that we're talking about. If we think in those terms, very different from the past, and that's where I want to say that, you've got to break today, and I hope my eminent panelists will hopefully lead us in that direction, because that is, you know, the nature of this re-engagement and how different it has to be as we go forward will, I think, make this session far more interesting. With those very few words, can I invite our first speaker, Mr. Jagdish Khattar. Thank you.
Kulkarni-san, distinguished panelists and friends. I think I have been helped by the preceding speakers who have spoken about the potential, where we are, and what we can do. So I'll confine mostly to my own experience with working with a Japanese company and what I see where they have gone wrong, because the potential, as you mentioned, if China has gone to 300 billion and India is only 16, things have not worked accordingly, and what could be done. So broadly speaking, I think today we have a very positive complementary between the two economies. Young India, aging Japan. We want make in India. Japanese are very good in manufacturing. We need FDI. They have savings. They need opportunities. We are good in service industry. They are very good in manufacturing. And I can give you an example of service industry in the automobiles. In India, we have a manufacturer, and the car goes directly to the dealer, whether it is KTM or anything. In Japan, you have a distribution company, you have dealers, and then you have sub-dealers. Four levels. That's why the Japanese economy and the cost goes up, because I think there is something that we can really help them in the service industry. We have talked about the political alignments that have taken place recently. We have entered into economic partnership agreement between the two prime ministers. We have annual meet. Second prime minister is the Japan. We earlier had annual meet with the Russian prime minister. And there is a broad-based engagement in trade and strategic areas. Mr. Rajiv Kumar has mentioned our trade is 16 billion. Our trade with Japan is 2% of ours. Theirs is 1% of ours. FDI, Aito-san has mentioned 1.5 billion last year, but if I remember, 700 million must be from SoftBank to Paytm. But if you remove that, then the quantity will not be so much. But we are really grateful to Japan for their assistance through the ODA. We were just discussing the major thing that Japan from the day one has done as far as the metro in Delhi is concerned. Today, Delhi has 190 kilometers of network, and the third phase, which finishes this year, will be additional 160. And there will be a revolution in Delhi as far as the metro is concerned. And they are also helping us in the freight corridor, Delhi-Bombay industrial corridor, etc. During Mr. Abe's visit, opportunities have been indicated. A mandate has been given by the Prime Minister's $35 billion investment, bullet train. If properly implemented, it will give a big boost to our manufacturing. Of course, the Japanese do have a tendency of sourcing a lot of things from their side. But I think gradually they need to change, because that will also help them in going into businesses in other countries if we can help them in manufacturing as much as possible locally. Defense and railways are opening up in a big way. And Japan is very good in manufacturing as far as the defense equipment is concerned. Huge opportunity there. Now, I'd like to share, come back to my experience, that what is the difference between Japan, Korea, and China in the last decade? I think Japanese came earlier, Koreans came later, but the Koreans came very aggressively, and they studied the market, and they went ahead. And that is why, even though Sony and all had come to India earlier, but LG and Samsung have taken over. But I must say that Japan has been a trendsetter as far as manufacturing culture in this country is concerned. And to that, I think credit goes to Suzuki Motor, which came in 83 when no one was coming here. Auto is a big success story as far as Japan is concerned. Japanese companies in auto are leading in two-wheeler and four-wheeler. Today, there are over 250 component manufacturers, Japanese manufacturers, either themselves or through joint ventures and technology. And they are all concentrated in Manesar, Gurgaon, Chennai, and now they are coming in Gujarat. As Toyota and Honda expand, and so does Nissan and Maruti, our estimate is that there will be 30% more component manufacturers coming to India. So the point I was really making was that as far as manufacturing is concerned, in mid-80s, that culture of wearing a uniform, common canteen, workers working along with them, that culture was brought about by the Japanese. And if you ask me, when India opened up in 90s, the first rush was for the from the automobile companies, because that was de-licensed. And why did they come? They found that Japanese had made a good base of component manufacturers. And they were able to replicate that, and the whole industry came. And India was also helped because yen appreciated to about 70, 75, 80 to a dollar. And it became very expensive for us to import. So localization had to take place. So we really must give credit to the Japanese as far as manufacturing is concerned. Now, a few things which I think, which is my experience with the Japanese, and why they have not been able to match with the Koreans and others. I think they are not aggressive. As was mentioned, they are very sober. All their qualities are there. But when you are entering into a country and when you wish to exploit opportunities, you have to be a little different. They are very cautious. In fact, they would like to see how others perform, see what mistakes they have made, and then follow. In that, you lose the leadership also. So that is what has happened in, as far as the Japanese are concerned. And I can give you an example. You know, they have a habit of comparing what happens in Japan, will it happen here? When in Maruti, we wanted to introduce True Value, second-hand cars, insurance aggregator, finance, my Japanese director said, "But Kato-san, this doesn't happen in Japan." So, I mean, humko jugaad karna pada, I was able to get it through, but the first benchmark is Japan. When I took over as a CEO and I had first meeting with Mr. O. Suzuki, our market share was down to 40. And he said, Kato-san, very unreal, 30 is the maximum. I said, why Suzuki-san? Because Toyota is 29 in Japan. So you cannot be more than 30. So I'm trying to say that when they come here, they have their own benchmarks and they wish to follow. The more important is to understand the local conditions and opportunities here, which I think the Koreans have done in a big way. And they've been able to score. Their decision making could be better. There is a strength in their decision making. Consensus, get everyone on board, etc., etc. So the execution becomes much easier. But the time taken is so huge that many a times we used to miss an opportunity. I think Toyota is here. In which country does Toyota have less than 5% market share? We feel embarrassed. Why? They can't make up their mind how to get a small car. They have Daihatsu has 51% shareholding. Now they have taken 100%, am I right? Now they are feeling, what's wrong with 51? And you see, our example, we wanted diesel. O Suzuki didn't allow us diesel. Why? Kato-san, there is no diesel in Japan. There's no diesel in America. So how can you have diesel in India? And we said, Suzuki-san, there's a difference of 30 rupees between the two. We have rural areas. 5 years it took us. But once we came, we were able to improve our market share. So the point I'm really making is that the Japanese have to become local, understand the local realities, and be more adaptable, little more aggressive, in order to make a headway in India. Of course, they have problems, which we also have, labor issues, land acquisition, ease of doing business. They have huge problems. We also have, but we try and sort it out. But the important thing is that even when they deal with our managers and unions, again, they feel that they would respond as the Japanese unions do, which they don't. In fact, I remember when I joined Maruti in 93, I went there and there was a union meeting, and that was a time when the Japanese economy was not doing well. The leader of the union was telling the chairman of the meeting, we know there is a problem, tell us what you expect from us. No demand, what is needed. This will never happen in India so easily. So we have really got to change our way of looking at it, and our motivation is very different. You know, Indians' expectations, Indians' managers, they don't have life employment. So we have really got to see how exactly we deal with them. Also, finish, 5 minutes. They are homogeneous and they feel more comfortable among themselves. Indians ke liye glass ceiling hai wahan pe. You have a look at Indian Japanese companies today. How many Indians are heading it? But you look at the European and American companies, they keep on changing. So with the result, lateral entry of good people is not so easy in Japanese company. But those who join Japanese company, they'll continue because they have a comfort zone. That's my feeling. I used to tell Maruti chaps, you go out, you'll fail. But you'll do here because you're in a comfort zone in a good company. So these are some of the things that are there. And their issue is that they wish to control from Japan. That's a major issue. Whereas adaptability has to be local. But we were lucky, you'll be surprised that in our operations, the local Japanese who were stationed in Japan, in India, used to fight our battle because they understood India better. So, a couple of points which I think can help. I think our chairman has mentioned about exposure, people to people. I think that's very important, and we used to advise Japanese managers to come and stay here for a few months, go around and get the feel of the country so that when they go back, they can respond better. Language is an issue. I think we need more language, Japanese to English, English to Japanese. And other thing which helped Maruti a lot, We sent our workers to work in Japan for 6 months. I think we must have spent 2,000 workers, 120 a year, over a period of 10 years. They brought about the culture of manufacturing here. I think if the Japanese companies could take Indian workers there and work for 6 months to a year, I think first, the understanding will improve. On return, they will be manufacturing better, become sort of, and they have that AOTS in Japan where they're, can you believe they learn the language within 6 weeks? They have that school there in Japan. So they can, this worker to worker would be extremely helpful. They should empower their local managements, have faith in Indians. I think these are the few words. What I can say is that Japanese have tremendous qualities in their area. We need them. We've got a platform today. We have learnings from them. They also have learnings from them. I think if we sit across the table, they can be identified. And I think this seminar today should help in that direction. Thank you.
I visited Japan for the first time a little over half a century ago, and there is a book lying on my table which recounts this half a century of connections with Japan. It was published last year, and Ambassador Yagi, the former ambassador to India, was kind enough to launch it at his embassy. Economic cooperation with Japan is not a post-war phenomenon at all. It began almost 1,000 years ago and in the field of textiles, what is called sarasa in Japan is in fact calico from India, and what is called shibori in Japan is in fact bantani, tie-and-dye techniques which went from here to Japan via China and sometimes by other routes. Also, even during the closed period, the 260 years till 1868, when Japan remained closed to the outside world, there were connections with India through the Dutch, based in Serampore in Bengal, and with Dejima, which was a port in Nagasaki. There were connections and there was trade between us. Of course, after the Meiji Restoration of 1868, things changed and improved. And it's interesting to note that when there was an exhibition hall set up in Calcutta in 1921 to display Japanese products, a Japanese consulate opened here in Bombay in 1896, I think, or 1898, and 5-6 years later in Calcutta, which was the capital. So Bombay was the center for commerce even then. And by the time we came to 1939, thanks to people like Shibusawa Eichi, Eichi Shibusawa, who was the third president of the Japan-India Association, founded in 1903, he founded the NYK line and very many other companies, there were great trade and shipping connections between India, Tokyo and Osaka. And that at 1939, India was the third largest trade partner of Japan after the United States and China. So we haven't always been at rank 26, where we are, I think, now. We were very important trade partners of the Japanese, and there were large Japanese communities living in Calcutta and Bombay even before the war. Now, we were told that the Japanese are cautious, I think with good reason. Don't forget, Toyota, who's represented here, came in the early 80s in a tie-up with DCM. And that, as you know, didn't work. When they came in the second time in the 90s, they were more cautious, and they found the Kirloskars, and they set up shop in Bangalore for the second time. Daiichi Sankyo, next to Takeda, the biggest pharmaceutical company of Japan, came in with Ranbaxy in 2008, a huge investment of a little under $4 billion, and we know that that didn't work. Perhaps not enough due diligence. We don't know what the reasons are, but it didn't work. Here in your own city, Tata NTT Docomo, $2.6 billion investment, for reasons that you know the experts here will tell us, that didn't work. So Japanese caution is well placed. In finding Indian partners, it is well placed. Please take your time and do it the Japanese way, sodan and ichi, which is consultation and consensus, which is the Japanese way of conducting business and negotiation. Coming now to what happened in December, a few weeks ago, when Prime Minister Abe was in Delhi, he really built on connections that have been established over the last 15 years. The big connections. It's not that Japan has not been helping India's infrastructure before Prime Minister Modi's visit in August 2000. They have. If you recall, in the early 70s, Mitsubishi in this city, Sagar Samrat, our first offshore oil drilling rig, was built by Mitsubishi, and our offshore oil drilling activity here was helped by Japan in the 70s. So it's not that they are new in the field of infrastructure. Yes, of course, after Prime Minister Modi came here and the visa regime became more easy, larger numbers of Indians moved to Japan to work there in IT companies and banks and some even in manufacturing companies like Hitachi and so on. But it is an incremental thing. For example, cleaning the Ganga was mentioned by Vajpayee, I think Mr. Kulkarni may have been there at the time, in his discussions with Koizumi. And the Delhi-Mumbai corridor was mooted when Koizumi came here in April 2005. And when Abe came in August 2007, they actually signed the agreement. So these things build up. It's not that everything started in 2014. All the discussions on the US-2, the amphibian aircraft, on other defense training and so forth, all began 4 or 5 years ago. Certainly in January 2014, when Prime Minister Abe was our chief guest at Republic Day, these items came up for discussion, and including civil cooperation, cooperation in civil nuclear energy and so forth. So in cooperation in rare earths, another very important area of economic cooperation between India and Japan, this has progressed incrementally. And the reason is that in 2012, the Chinese got a little annoyed with the Japanese, so they cut off all exports of rare earths to Japan, and that put their industry, their chip industry, into real problems. And so from 2012, I think it was Prime Minister Noda at the time, we've been talking about rare earths, and on each visit, we exchange visits, by the way, every year. It's the only country that we do that with. We do it with the Russians, but with Japan, for Japan, it's the only country in the world that they have annual visits at the summit level, prime ministerial level, and of course at the METI level, the Ministry of Economy, Trade and Industry, and our Commerce and Industry Minister. In the days when we had a planning minister, we used to have bilateral exchanges and so forth. So, yes, you mentioned quite correctly, Mr. Chairman, the high-speed rail link, which they are building for us between Bombay and Ahmedabad. This, again, is an old project which has been worked upon. In fact, it was decided during Manmohan Singh's time that the feasibility project would be ready in 2015. That's why the work started in 2015. But the ideas have been made by the Japanese in consultation with us from before. So that's broadly what I really have to say at this point. We'll take it on from there. Thank you.
Morning, members of the dais, ladies and gentlemen. I think it's only appropriate that two automotive people are speaking at this occasion, given the dominance of the automobile industry in Japan. And increasingly, the automobile industry in India is also being looked at as an employment generator in our own country. Very quickly, and you have the right to throw a water bottle at me if I don't finish in 10 minutes. No, without opening the cap. Very quickly, I think my experience in working with Toyota, and I've been with them since their inception in India in their second avatar, not in their first avatar, since 1998. And one of the things that I'd been absolutely struck by is their focus on developing human resources. And I think this focus on developing human resources has stood not only the automobile industry in good stead, it has also helped the auto component industry a great deal. All of us in the automobile industry owe a lot to Maruti Suzuki, because they've been the first mover in the country, literally, apart from, of course, you did have Standard Motors and Hindustan Motors. But really, the forerunners of success in the automobile industry has been Suzuki Motor Corp's Maruti Suzuki venture, as we currently know it. A lot of their suppliers, they were able to groom, develop, etc., and we've all been major beneficiaries. I still remember that when we started our operations here, the PPM level, that's the parts per million, which is the metric on which we measure defectives from the auto component industry and that flows to the automobile industry, was something like 900 ppm. And I was aghast because in Japan, the level was at 4 ppm. And, you know, and I thought to myself, you know, I mean, how on earth are we ever going to improve? And, you know, and I can only picture doomsday scenarios. But very quickly, within a few years, we had broken the 100 ppm mark. And today, as I stand before you, we're challenging 8 ppm, and that's the level to which our auto component makers have improved. And I think it is in large measure to the dedicated efforts of companies like Maruti Suzuki, Toyota, Honda, etc., who have developed auto component makers to bring them to a level where, you know, they can seriously challenge the world and export. So I think that's the first point that I want to make. The second point, and if you don't mind my blowing my trumpet a little bit, in Toyota, you know, we have what is called a shipping quality audit, which means that before the cars get out to the marketplace, this is an annual audit that comes, and they check how good is the car to just go straight into the showroom and be sold. And there, by that yardstick, and they do this, and there's a team that goes all around the world auditing our 26 different automobile plants around the world. And I'm happy to share with you that the Toyota plant in Bangalore has stood first in the last 3 years of its operations. So I think that's a feather in India's cap in terms of how we develop human resources, and kudos to the Japanese who have focused their efforts on this human resources development. The next point that I want to focus on is on the pollution issue. I do think pollution is a very, very serious issue that is affecting the national health of the country. If you look at the plume index, it lists Mumbai and Delhi as extreme pollution, meaning they're somewhere in the 200 plus index in terms of, and it's been classified by WHO as being absolutely hazardous for health. And I think whoever is making the noises in Delhi is absolutely right in complaining about the pollution. And I think many of us, we are actually jeopardizing the health of our younger citizens. So the focus is right, but what do we do about it? And how can we engage with Japan in getting their expertise and solving this problem for us. Remember, Tokyo and Nagoya have as many cars and a population density which is as thick as Delhi or Mumbai. But if you look at the plume index, it says clear air, fresh air. And if you look at London, you look at Atlanta, look at New York, you get these same similar readings. So the problem in India is not really caused by vehicles per se. There are a number of other arguments one can adduce, but this is not the forum. The point I want to make is we should, going forward, utilize the expertise of the Japanese, engage in meaningful cooperation with them, and improve the air quality in our cities. I think we owe it to our citizens, we owe it to the next generation, and I think whatever we can do in this regard must be done and should be done beginning today, if possible. So, what is Toyota's blueprint for the future? Yes, there was a remark made about how we are not able to sell small cars, and I do concede that we have not been able to sell small cars because small cars has never been Toyota's area of focus or expertise. We are in whichever segments we have entered, in terms of gasoline vehicles, in terms of diesel vehicles, we have done very well. In the Innova segment, we've got about, I think, 40-45% of the market. In the Fortuner segment, we've got about 60-65% of the market. In Corolla, we've got about 30%. It's only in the small car segment that we have 5%. That's okay. But what is important, and here again, I go back to the pollution question, in the context of the diesel ban that's recently occurred in Delhi, we had a portfolio that was selling both petrol and diesel. The government of India subsidized diesel. We never asked for that subsidy. The consumers never asked for that subsidy. They gave that subsidy because they had a different political agenda in mind. And willy-nilly, what happened was the demand for the Innova, as an example, was 99% Innova and 1% petrol. And there came a time when it was 100% Innova and nobody was buying petrol vehicles, so we had to phase out the petrol option. So we are in a difficult situation as far as Delhi is concerned. But be that as it may, we can't dwell on the past. We have to look to the future. And here is where I'd like to draw... Am I running out of time? Or okay. And here is where I'd like to draw a comparison between Japan and India. Japan is a country that imports all its crude oil. I think we import something like 85% to 90% of our crude oil. Japan makes the world's best cars. So is there a lesson for us? Yes. We also have a car industry that's dominated by the Japanese. It's Suzuki, Toyota, Honda, Nissan, etc. While every other car maker is also here making automobiles, I think the dominance of the Japanese must be understood and appreciated. And therefore, going forward, what's the roadmap that Toyota has in terms of making the earth more pollution friendly or for it to get rid of pollution? First, we make the hybrid cars, which means that your fuel efficiency is much better, which means your carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide emissions are much lower. Where diesels are used, your particulate matter will be much lower, and it's also indexed largely to the kind of fuels that are available. We never told the government of India, don't introduce Euro 3, Euro 4 fuel across the country. Even today, as I speak with you, you have a dual fuel structure. You have Euro 3 in some parts of the country and Euro 4 fuels in some parts of the country. We've been waiting for Euro 4 to get introduced for a long, long time. And we wanted a roadmap for Euro 5 and Euro 6, and we haven't got that. And the reason is, they gave too much subsidy, they starved the oil companies of cash, and the oil companies couldn't give a roadmap for introducing fuels that would be cleaner. I think this is the reality. Of course, now we have to solve our problem of pollution, and Toyota's solution going out to 2050 is to have a world where we de-emphasize fossil fuels completely. We will have electric fuels, electric vehicles, we will have hybrid vehicles, and we will have hydrogen vehicles. Can we have a world where we will have hydrogen, where we will have a society that depends on hydrogen, not just for its transportation needs, but also for its manufacturing? And that's the vision to take. And that's where I see India and Japan's economic cooperation fructifying and going forward very decisively in the years and decades to come. I'm happy to take more questions on this going forward, but I don't want to exhaust my time. Thank you very much.
That you will start manufacturing the Prius in India sooner than later. And also that you will introduce your fuel cell car, not in California, but in India. So that'll be the day to do come. And that's the future that I was talking about in my intervention. Ladies and gentlemen, our next speaker is Ms. Dr. Ajit Ranade, the Chief Economist at the Aditya Birla Group. Ajit.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, everybody. So I'll try and bring some economic perspective. And actually, I was hoping Consul General Ito would be here because I'm going to say something about Japan, and now I can be sure that I was worried whether I may say something which is not correct factually, but anyway, Ambassador Sait is here. So I just want to say a few by way of points of data and maybe thoughts sort of provoking some discussion later. First of all, Japan has still, in dollar terms, the third highest GDP in the world. It has got the third highest forest cover in the world. Forest. It has got the highest rainfall among OECD countries. Probably not so. I mean, I think forest and rainfall go together. So it's an amazing, remarkable thing that a rich country has the highest rainfall. Highest life expectancy among the major countries, 84 years. There's only 3% obesity in Japan. The USA is struggling with almost 50% obesity. So this is a rich country disease, they call it, but Japan has only 3% obesity. There have been no religious wars that we know of in modern times. In these times of Syria and, I thought it's important to mention. So this is some few tidbits to think about. Second point, I think these three major initiatives of the current prime minister or the current regime are highly relevant to Indo-Japan collaboration, cooperation, exchange. And I think Mr. Kulkarni mentioned it, and I wholeheartedly endorse what you said in your opening remarks. So Swachh India, Digital India, Make in India. All three have highly relevant, a Japanese role in all three, extremely relevant. It's not for nothing that we refer to the earlier environmental accord as the Kyoto Protocol. So Kyoto has come permanently imprinted. But Swachh India, Digital India, and Make in India. The Japanese are the world leaders in miniaturization and renewable energy today, but I don't need to say that to this audience. Third point is that while we talk about economic cooperation, this session is about economic exchange, and therefore our chairman also talked about the trade linkage. Actually, all three go together, I think. Economic, political, and cultural. So you can't separate. They all go together. And therefore, all the comments about the fact that language exchange, training of mutual languages, all those are, I think, important. But just to put this in slight context, a lot was mentioned about Indo-Japanese trade today. I just want to give you, of course, Mr. Chairman said that China-Japan trade is $340 billion. By the way, India-China trade, so India was the 19th most important export destination for China. China, as you know, is one of the world's leading trading countries in terms of exports and imports. And India was ranked number 19 just about 12 years ago. Today, India's rank from China is number 6 and fast moving to number 5. So the Indian market is extremely important to the Chinese manufacturers and Chinese exporters. And it is actually seen. So I'm not even quoting the dollar numbers. The relative ranking of importance of a country like India, which in PPP terms is the third biggest in the world, purchasing power parity terms. And in pure dollar terms, it's probably the seventh largest in the world. And the Chinese, so why is it that in Indo-Japan, we are still stuck at number 26 or number 25? So this is at least in relative ranking. Other number to look at in terms of context, Indo-Japan trade is about $12 billion today, $12, $13 billion. Guess what is the size of Indo-Iran trade? Now, keep in mind that Iran was under sanctions still very recently. No, very lot of restrictions on doing trade with Iran. Indo-Iran trade is $14 billion even in the sanction period. So that's why I took that example. I mean, so, and it's very quickly, I think in the next 3 or 4 years, I predict that Indo-Iran trade will grow to $24 billion post-sanction. So, and Indo-Japan is still stuck at $12 billion. So let's be, you know, the ground realities are important. While we talk about HSR, you know, here probably in India, HSR is more known for the Hosur-Sarjapur road rather than high-speed rail. So it's going to take some time. I know that DMIC, DMRC, and now high-speed rail, these are very high-profile. But what we need is much more ground reality stuff between SMEs, and, you know, there's a long way to go. So here I'd like to point out the complementarities. And I think these are well-known, but it's worth repeating. So demography, growth, capital, and inflation. Inflation, of course, is a very temporary thing, but I thought I'd mention it anyway. There are four structural complementarities: demography, growth, capital, and inflation. What is demography? Young people, aging society. So India's median age is 27 years, and it's going to be 27 for a long foreseeable future. Japan is an aging society. In fact, Japanese population of 100 million, right? 120 million. India is 1.2 billion, but Japan is shrinking, actually. The population growth rate of Japan is negative. So demography is complementarity. We have to find out to take advantage of this mutual. Second, growth. Japan is a zero growth economy, or almost negative in nominal terms. India is one of the fastest growing economy in the world. Can we find this complementarity? Number three, capital. Japan is highly capital rich, in the sense that the savings capital is huge. India is, I would submit, capital starved. This is I know that there's some debate about this, but by and large, for our growth aspirations, we are capital starved. So capital rich, capital poor, complementarity. Finally, inflation. Japan has negative inflation, or what is called deflation. India still recently was struggling with high inflation. There's no, I haven't found of, you know, no economist has found this trick to trade inflation with each other. I'm reminded that Mr. Abe, by the way, the Japanese people in the last 25 years have had 17 prime ministers, or 18, I think. So Mr. Abe, if he completes two more years, and I hope he does, he'll be the longest serving prime minister in the modern history. And when he was campaigning for his election, and he won by a pretty impressive landslide, and Mr. Modi's victory was compared, his campaign promise was, people, please vote for me, I will give you inflation. At that time, you know, you imagine what was happening in India. So if there's some way of complementarity. So, I mean, just to conclude, 1 or 2 minutes. Well, I said that Japan was zero growth and all that, and the three very important, what I call aces up their sleeve. You know, we say that Japan has been stagnant. I don't think that's the correct word to use. There are three aces up the Japanese sleeve in terms of macroeconomy. Because they say, you know, the highest debt, we talk about Greek debt, we talk about India's debt to GDP ratio, we talk about the fiscal deficit in India, but the highest indebted country in the world as debt to GDP ratio is actually Japan. It's close to 300%. But the three aces up their sleeve is, number one is that the debt is mostly owed to Japanese people. So the Japanese government owes its debt to Japanese people, completely inside. It's not like the other countries where the debt is owed to foreigners, like in Greece or in other countries. So debt is completely domestically owned. Secondly, while the nominal GDP is maybe shrinking or 0% growth, but since the population is shrinking, the denominator is shrinking, so the per capita GDP, that is GDP divided by population, is actually increasing. So the standard of living is actually improving, and not to speak of other innovation like miniaturization, electronics, and renewable energy. And thirdly, the participation of women in the labor force in Japan compared to OECD countries is actually relatively low. So there is one potential trigger for growth and a big spurt of productivity in their economy is that if there are laws and policies and incentives for more women to participate in the labor force compared to OECD countries and peers, that would be a huge boost. So while it's fashionable to say that it's a stagnant economy, that's a very incorrect description of Japan. All said and done, it is still the third largest in the GDP. And what's most impressive is the fact that they value their environment so much. And this is one country, I think Mr. Kulkarni said, they actually probably in their national accounts value their natural capital as much as their physical and financial capital. Lastly, about, in a lighter vein, we have, as I said, this linkage should be seen as not just economic, but economic, cultural, and political. And sometimes I think we take it a little further to talk about electoral politics. So that country has told us that it's a country of the rising sun, and we have the country of the rising suns. So, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Ajit. Thank you very much. And, this thing about the environment, and, you mentioned last toward the natural capital. I think there is already some study, some work starting, whereby you can include the use of natural capital in the GNP. And that, I think, if Japan and India can work at it together. But that's not yet a developed science. And there are some papers, but if you can do that, I think it'll be really nice. And I think that's the challenge, which is that can Japan and India innovate together to go forward. Ladies and gentlemen, our next and last speaker of this panel is Mr. Mayur Shah, who's the Assistant General Manager at the Mizuho Bank here in Mumbai. Mr. Shah.
Chairman ORF Kulkarniji, eminent panelist, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Unlike other members, Mizuho Bank, though big, but it's hardly known in India. So before I come to my presentation on how as a bank is trying to become a bridge, because our basic business is lending money to companies and projects. So before I go into that, allow me a little bit on introducing about my bank. We are one of the three largest mega banks from Japan. Size-wise, you can say asset-wise as being a Citibank. Important thing is 70% of the listed Japanese companies are our client. And more importantly, 100,000 SMEs, they count us as their first bankers. Not to mention, we also deal with very good Indian companies as well as the blue chip Asian companies. We started our operations in India 20 years back, and Mumbai is our home state. We started operation from that. 10 years back, we had our branch open in Delhi. Now we are present in Chennai, Bangalore, as well as Ahmedabad. We also have our security division that is headquartered out of Mumbai. So if we take the 6 locations, we are the largest presence in terms of offices from any Japanese banks in India. That shows our commitment. And I'll be touching upon later, but there are 2 G2G projects that Mizuho is involved in. One of them is in Chennai, and another one is in Haryana. So that makes our presence pan-India and fairly elaborate. Now, there's something unique about Mizuho that when we are planning to expand our business, and when I relocated to India, and we are trying to see that how we can increase FDI from Japan, because that would be directly correlated with our own business. And when we started speaking with customers, we figured out that many a time, the approvals or all the procedures, it gets stuck at the state level. And that's where we thought that why don't we positively engage state governments? And way back in 2009, before we started expanding our branch networks, first we signed an MOU with government of Gujarat, that they were also looking to engage Japan in a very positive way. We worked along with them. Second state was Tamil Nadu. We focused on these 2 states because both of them had a huge potential in terms of port infrastructure. And we envisaged that going forward, integrating India into global economy for the Japanese company is going to be very important. And we were very lucky to get a positive response from both states. Later on, the collaboration expanded to Karnataka. And very recently, we also signed MOUs with government of Andhra Pradesh, Haryana, and most importantly with Maharashtra. It'll be interesting to know that what we emphasized in 2009 actually proved so right, because in last 18 months, we have seen 8 state high-level delegations visiting Japan. Of course, all the hard works were done by Ambassador State and Ambassador Prasad in the audience, but now is when we are seeing the results in a big way. And out of these 8 delegations, 5 were led by the chief ministers themselves. Now that shows that states themselves are looking to compete at a larger level. And we at Mizuho, we felt that cooperating with them will give us a huge leverage to help our Japanese clients. Of course, we also have a relationship on the financial parts. Now coming straight to the FDI issues. Now, quite a few things has been already discussed. I'll be very quick with that. In nutshell, even if you take last, 10 years or 12 years, Japan is top 5 FDI provider, even though the numbers are small, but it still is top 5 destination for India to receive FDI. If you consider that Mauritius is the most one, and which is more of a diverting thing, it speaks a lot about the credential of Japan numbers. But as already been discussed about, with respect to India-China or China-Japan by Chair and Mr. Ronade, there is a huge potential. Now let's look at what kind of investment patterns that Japan has in India, as well as what kind of investment Japan has in other countries. On the left-hand side, you can see that there is a consistent growth in both in terms of Japanese companies, as well as their establishment. A trend you can see clearly that there are lesser companies but more establishment. What I mean to say that the companies are getting more and more confident. They started their office somewhere in, say, Gurgaon, a factory in, say, Manesar, next factory in Chennai, and that's how they're expanding. So they, I mean, as and when they are getting confident, the expansion is there. Interestingly, if you look on the right-hand side, and this is about how a proportion of export sales to the total sales of Japanese companies in these countries, starting with, say, I mean, India, Myanmar, Indonesia, Thailand. And overall, if you look at it, the average is that 34% of Japanese companies' sales in the host country normally goes to the export. Now, I'm not even comparing China here. I'm looking at Indonesia, which is sort of a comparable, these things. And compared to Indonesia also, we are only half of it. Indonesia is 25%, we are only at 12.5%. So what are the problems that hinders them? Of course, there could be many, and there are plenty of surveys also, because Japanese companies are very good at responding to survey very deliberately and, I mean, detailed. So these are the points which JBIC came across on their surveys. If you look at the bottom 5, they are more related to what I would say an ease of doing business. And I believe just like the states are wooing the investors, they are also aggressively looking at improving their own way of doing business. Improving their ease of doing business parameters. But the most important one is the top one, where India fares so badly. And that's what they call it, underdeveloped infrastructure. Now, when I say underdeveloped infrastructure, and what the Japanese mean, they don't just mean that power or water. When they say underdeveloped infrastructure, what they mean is that I am an SME. If I am putting a plant in India, can I consider that my Indian plant will be integrated in a global supply chain in a 24/7? So the most important point then comes is, do I get a land at a place where approvals will be faster, where I can only focus on my own business, and then can I move on further? Now, this is the point even both Japanese government and Indian government also realized. And that's where last April, we had an MOU signed between Ministry of Commerce and Industry and a METI, where besides large projects like DMICs and DFCs and HSR and other things, this is more of a low-hanging fruits. And actually, these are the more important, because this is where the actual the growth potential in terms of creating employment, SMEs to SMEs, happen. So there are 11 candidate sites identified for JIT, which is called Japanese Industrial Township. And this has been done in collaboration with various state governments, and Japanese companies' inputs were taken. Now, Mizuho also participates in this initiative, because ultimately it helps it promote the Indian goal of Make in India. We have a dedicated team which helps towards generating next generation smart infrastructure. So here we consult to those projects or particular city if it wants to go on the smart part, or it wants to develop this kind of industrial infrastructure, which in turn will host the Japanese investors. Because not only it's important for the growth of the Japanese company, but it also helps the growth of the host countries. And this is the one big project that we participated first. This is also part of the GIT. We partnered with a Singapore company, Ascendas. And what we did was we also involved government of Tamil Nadu, saying that this is what we want to create, a hub where your state's credential also improves. And then we got METI also signed an MOU with Tamil Nadu government. So this is one of its kind project, 55 kilometers away from Chennai, and it's taking on well. Second project that we are involved at this moment is in Haryana. The land is owned by the private player Reliance Industries, and we are looking into at this moment along with our partners Marubeni. Here also, METI has sort of interested Mizuho and our Marubeni partner to figure it out that how attractive it can be made for the Japanese investor, because considering Gurgaon is one of the most biggest hub. And talking about the state where we are sitting right now, we have also looked at the another kind of a model. When Honorable Chief Minister of Maharashtra visited Japan, we signed an MOU with MIDC. And in the same spirit, we have decided to help SUPA, the industrial township, which is also part of the JIT. And what we did was we have another understanding with the JETRO, and then JETRO and MIDC signed. So any company want to invest, MIDC will handhold, JETRO will provide the framework, and Mizuho will be providing financial support. So in nutshell, since next week, it's a big week for Maharashtra, and Make in India is happening here. Mizuho should also contribute to Make in India, and since Maharashtra is our home state, we also hope to contribute to Make in Maharashtra. Thank you very much. Arigatou gozaimasu.
Very good. Thank you very much. And thanks to our panelists, we've actually made up 15 minutes in this session. So with the organizer's permission, I'll carry the session on till 11:45, 11:40, and then break because we started about half.